Everybody, a very good morning as usual to each and every one of you. I hope that all of you are safe there. So we are going on forward with our online classes, and I hope that the communication between us is very warm and very cozy as it was in the previous sessions when we used to have online classes in the Google Meet. So I've told you earlier the reason why I'm scheduling classes through the video recordings are why because I want all of you to be able to access whatever information I am passing, and also you should be able to read and perhaps hear what I want to say in the class even during your exams. I know that most of you want an interactive sessions, but I'm really sorry because I know that many of you will have network coverage issues. Even I will have network coverage issues and I won't be able to access you at the proper time, and we even had to spend much of our time like that, and hence I feel that this is a PowerPoint that I have put my whole work into. I have made it more interesting and also have put so many pictures into it, and I feel that it will be very good for you. I mean, even each slides and the pictorial representations that each of these slides have will have an enduring effect on your mind. So we are going to deal with Philip Sidney and the Defense of Poetry. It is held in the module 2 of literary criticism syllabi which we are covering. So today onwards we are going to start our module 2. So who is Philip Sidney? Do you know Philip Sidney? Anybody? No. I'm just unable to hear you because it's not an interactive session. So let us move forward with our class. Okay. Biography of Philip Sidney. Sir Philip Sidney lived an active life as a courtier, soldier, diplomat and writer. I'm sorry for that spelling mistake. It is soldier, diplomat and writer. He was born at Penshurst Palace in Kent in 1554. Sidney began writing poetry in 1578 and his writing career only lasted 7 to 8 years. His The Defense of Poesy was originally published under two different titles. So you have to, the first point that we have to study is his critical appreciation of poetry, the treatise which is named as The Defense of Poesy. The Defense of Poesy, the word repairana, The Defense of Poesy in a different spelling, and an apology for poetry. So we are going to start our module 2, the Philip Sidney's An Apology for Poetry. An Apology for Poetry. So you can see that an apology of poetry is truly an attack against a Puritan poet or a Puritan critic whose name was Stephen Gosson. This Stephen Gosson, he says that poets are liars, poets have to be banished, he justifies Plato and says that poets must be banished. And you can see that the whole treatise, An Apology for Poetry, is an answer to Stephen Gosson's School for Abuse. His Stephen Gosson's work is The School for Abuse. So to Sidney, poetry is an imitation for a particular specific purpose. It is imitated, and it is the purpose of this poetry is to teach and delight. Poetry is something that he takes to be something that is superior to the means of communication, and its value depends upon what is communicated. So he says that history is something that is described as lively, passionate, etc. But poetic expressions can be found even in history. Okay, he prefers imaginative literature, and he says that literature is better than history and philosophy. So in the earlier context, you have already studied that Plato says philosophy is something greater than poetry, isn't it? And somebody else will be saying that it's not like that. So in the same way, here also Stephen Gosson has written a critical treatise, the name of which is The School for Abuse and An Apology for Poetry, is a reply to Stephen Gosson's work. Okay. Now, like the best of the Elizabethans, he lived in the Elizabethan period, and like the best of the Elizabethans, Sidney was successful in more than one branch of literature. But none of his literary output was published until after his death. His finest achievement was his connected sequence of 108 love sonnets. And you can see that his other major works are Astrophel and Stella, which was written in 1591, a pastoral romance named as The Arcadia, which was written in 1598, and he is most famous for his critical treatise, An Apology for Poetry, which was written in 1595, which was published in 1595 actually. Now we can see some points. That is, Edmund Spenser dedicated The Shepherd's Calendar, his famous work, The Shepherd's Calendar, for Philip Sidney. He was one of the best sonnet writer, just like Shakespeare during his period. Now we can see a peek into An Apology for Poetry. An Apology for Poetry is a thorough and vigorous argument written by a practitioner of the art who also had a strong education in the classics. So here you can see Philip Sidney was a poet. And hence, you can see that the criticism that he does is through his own eyes. He is a practitioner of literary art. Therefore, he knows literary art better than anybody else. In the case of Plato and Aristotle, you can see that both of them were philosophers. They were not writers, and hence, they tried to analyze everything through the eyes of philosophy. But later on, when you take the case of Horace, you can see that he was also a poet and he was also a writer, and hence the criticism that he does was on the basis of his own experiences. In the same way, you can see that Philip Sidney was a writer, a poet, a critic, and he analyzes the literary subject or the literary form in the eyes of a poet or a writer. Now, it is generally believed that he was partly motivated by Stephen Gosson. I've told you earlier, isn't it? Stephen Gosson was a former playwright. He was a Puritan playwright who dedicated his attack on the English stage, the School for Abuse, School of Abuse, to Sidney in 1579. Always remember, it is An Apology for Poetry and The School of Abuse, not School for Abuse, School of Abuse. But Sidney primarily addresses more general objections to poetry, such as those of Plato. Plato's edirthond സംസാരിക്കുന്നുണ്ട്, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ പ്ലേറ്റോയുടെ റിമാർക്ക് അങ്ങനെ ഉദ്ദേശിക്കുന്ന രീതിയിലല്ല എന്ന് പറയുന്നുണ്ട് ഇവിടെ ആര്? ഫിലിപ്പ് സിഡ്നി. ഇൻ ഹിസ് എസ്സേ, സിഡ്നി ഇന്റഗ്രേറ്റ്സ് എ നമ്പർ ഓഫ് ക്ലാസിക്കൽ ആൻഡ് ഇറ്റാലിയൻ പ്രീസെപ്റ്റ്സ് ഓൺ ഫിക്ഷൻ. ഹി സേസ് അബൌട്ട് സെവറൽ ക്ലാസിക്കൽ ആൻഡ് ഇറ്റാലിയൻ പ്രീസെപ്റ്റ്സ് ഓഫ് ഫിക്ഷൻ. നൗ ദ നെക്സ്റ്റ് സ്ലൈഡ്. The essence of his defense is that poetry by combining the liveliness of history with an ethical focus on philosophy is more effective than either history or philosophy in arousing its readers to virtue. So you can see that poetry is a combination of history and has a focus like a philosophy, and therefore it is supreme than history or philosophy in raising the readers to virtue. The work also offers important comments on Edmund Spenser and the Elizabethan stage. Edmund Spenser name, Elizabeth stage name pattiyulla remarks okka ee workinte agathu undu. Now the method used. What is the method used by Philip Sidney? The method used is historiographical biographical approach, which incorporated the ideas of three classicists, mainly Plato, Aristotle and Horace. Now this particular work, An Apology for Poetry, was written in 1579, but it was published in 1595. He is also used contemporary ways to defend poetry through philosophy and religion. So he makes use of philosophy and religion in order to defend his views. The Apology for Poetry was said to be the exponent of literary criticism in England. He is the first English literary critic. Now he deals with two main ideas in his work. The first one is the divine origin of poetry, and the second one is the social utility of poetry. Appa divine origin of poetry, social utility of poetry mana two main points that you can see in his work, An Apology for Poetry. Now the whole section. The first section praises poetry. In his first section, in the first section of the book, he praises poetry. He says that poetry is a cradle for civilization. Civilization urangunna oru thottilana. It is a channel for the divine power. Divine power. What is divine power? God. So it is the channel of God. It is the channel through which God appears in front of these beings. Next one is, it can teach and delight. Poetry can teach and delight. And the fourth point is, it surpasses or it outcomes, it outgrows history and philosophy. Now the second section. In the second section, he refutes or he goes against the argument put forward by Stephen Gosson in his The School for Abuse. Remember, I've told you earlier, it was School of Abuse. It is not the School for Abuse. So always remember, ingane korchu mistakes okke ende PowerPoint le vannalum, you should have to think that it is the School of Abuse. Gosson's arguments were: poetry is unprofitable, poetry is the mother of lie, poetry leads to sinful behavior, and the fourth one is Plato kicked the poets out of his republic. Appa edakkana poetry patti he negative writer Stephen Gosson parayunnathu. He says that poetry is an unprofitable venture. He says that poetry is the mother of lies, and he says that poetry leads to sinful behavior, and the fourth one is he justifies that Plato had kicked poets out of his republic. Now the next point, the age in which Sidney lived. What is the peculiarity of the age in which Sidney had lived? Sidney lived in an age when Renaissance was flourishing. The intellectuals were booming around. They were going around and they were trying to deviate themselves into new areas of thinking. Now, Sidney's defense of poetry against Gosson. First one, poetry is the source of knowledge and is a civilizing force. The second one is a poet cannot lie as he is the creator of a fiction that cannot lie. He says that poetry is true, or the writing part in poetry or the ideas in poetry is true, and hence a poet cannot lie. To him, it is the people who abuses poetry and not vice versa. What is that? Stephen Gerson already has said that Plato had banished poets from his republic, and hence here Sidney is saying that it is the people who abuses poetry and not poetry that abuses people. Now, early in the defense of poesy, so there will be an interchanging of the title, the defense of poetry, an apology for poetry, angane interchanging ivda kaanan pattum. Early in the defense of poesy, Sidney states, ayinte thodakkam, having slept into the title of a poet, I am provoked to say something unto you in the defense of that my unelected vocation. So he says that he is a poet. He is having the title of a poet, and thereby he is provoked, or he is forced to say something to you people in defense of his unelected. He didn't elect that vocation or that particular job, for instance. It is something that was innate in him, something that was inborn in him. In the piece, he defends poor poetry and argues that poetry, whose final end is to lead and draw us to as high a perfection as our degenerate souls, made worse by their clay lodgings, can be capable of. He says that poetry is capable of purifying our soul. It is capable of taking our soul from a drowsy area, or that particular soul is lying there very passive, and that soul can be taken into the spirit of elevation. And therefore he says that poetry is the best vehicle for the purifying of the wit. What is wit? Wit is knowledge. He forms his argument in a classical 7-part structure, beginning with an introduction and moving through the stages of proposition, division, examination, and refutation to a final peroration, and including, as custom permitted, a digressio in a related issue. Therefore, he says that in his argument, he says that the 7 parts are there. What are the 7 parts? Introduction undu. Then later, he says to the moving stages of proposition. What is the idea proposed there? Now, he says about the different divisions of poetry. Now, he examines each of them. He refutes the final thing. He refuses, or he goes against what was told by Stephen Gerson. And including, as custom permitted, a digressio on a related issue. He says on, he depends on, or he explains on a particular related issue. In the defense of poesy, he references classical text and analyzes or examines different forms of poetry. So that is something that I told to you earlier. Next point. Sidney concludes by entertaining the thought that his reader cannot hear the planet like music of poetry. Planet like music in which anda? The music is universal. So he concludes by entertaining the thought that his reader may not be able to understand, or he may not be able to comprehend what he is talking about. If that is the case, if the reader cannot comprehend, then if the reader has so earth-creeping a mind that it cannot lift itself up to look to the sky of poetry, if the person who is reading this kind of work is not able to uplift his soul through the poetry, Then I must send you in the behalf of all poets that you live in love and never get favor of lacking skill of a sonnet. So I will be privileged to tell you, or I will be asked to tell you what I am going to tell you, that you are of course living in love, but you never get a favor for a skill to write a sonnet. And when you die, your memory is dying from the earth for want of an epitaph. Epitaph means something that can be written when you die. Epitaph ennu vacha nammalde death inde samayathu writing is there. Here lies the bones of the person who wrote like that. Angane ok parney ezhuthille. Udaharanathine Keats inde epitaph ennu parayunnathu endha parayana, Keats inde epitaph ennu parayana, here lies one whose name was written in water. Ayalude peru vellathil ezhuthiyathu poleyirunnu. He was not famous when he was alive. So he says, Sidney says that if the reader doesn't love poetry, then I must have to say that you are a person who is devoid of the talent to write a poetry, and hence the memories through which you are living will be dead after some time. It will be dead after some time and it will be gone forever with you. And therefore, after your death, you will be asking, or you will be wanting to have an epitaph. Okay. Sidney says that Plato in his Republic wanted to banish people who abused poetry and not the poets. Now Sidney shows in his essay that poetry is in fact the monarch of all the arts, or the king of all the arts. Sidney does so. How does he say that? He is reasoning that by articulating a theory of poetry largely drawn from classical writers as tool for teaching virtue, and the poet as a semi-divine figure capable of imagining a more perfect version of nature. So he glorifies a poet. He says that a poet is a divine human being or a godlike figure. After God, only poet can write or beautify or glorify the nature around him. Therefore, he says that poetry is the monarch of all the arts. Armed with this definition, Sidney proceeds to address the major criticisms made of the art of poetry and of the poets who practice it. So, this definition is the main theme that he has in this particular treatise, and with this particular definition, he proceeds to address the major criticisms drawn against poetry by Stephen Gosson. Okay, and how does he refute or how does he defend this poetry? By his brilliant rhetorical skill. He says or he refuses whatever Stephen Gosson is saying by his brilliant rhetorical skill. Indeed, many of the famous classical philosophers and historians wrote in poetry, and even those who wrote in prose like Plato and Herodotus wrote poetically. He says that everything in this world was written poetically. Even the prose or the prosaic features of Herodotus and Plato, they were also written very poetically. That is, they used poetical style to come up with philosophical allegories. In the case of Plato, or to supply vivid historical details in the case of Herodotus. So, who are the classicists he is taking? He is taking the case of Plato as well as Herodotus. Indeed, without borrowing from poetry, historians and philosophers would never have become popular. He says that in order to write something good, in order to glorify a written concept, some poetic measurements or poetry should have to be used. Otherwise, the person who is writing will not get famous. One can get some indication of the respect in which the poets were held in the ancient world by examining the names they were given in Latin and Greek. weights and pointers. So he says that in order to understand the particular position that the poets used to have during the Greek and the Roman periods, you have to understand what was the position or the name that was given to that particular position. What was the name? Weights or pointers. So that was what he old Greek people used to call the poets. Now, weights means seer or prophet. Seer means a visionary, a person who looks into the future. So, weights is equivalent to a seer or a prophet. Therefore, a poet is also a seer or a prophet. And in the classical world, poetry was considered to convey important knowledge about the future. So in the past, poetry was considered to convey important, only the important knowledge about what? About the future of that particular time. Now, poetess, it means maker. And this title reflects the fact that poets, like God, create new and more perfect realities using their imaginations. So, what are they capable of? They are capable of creating more perfect realities, and even they are capable of making a different world, and therefore they are equivalent to God. Sidney moves to the proposition. Now, he moves to the proposition that definition of poetry is an art of imitation that teaches its audience through delight or pleasure. So what is the, after all, what is the conclusion? The aim of poetry is to teach through delight or pleasure. In its ability to embody ideas in compelling images, what are the images? The figures of speech that are used. So, in order to attain or delight or pleasure, it embodies, it includes ideas in different figures of speech. Poetry is almost like a speaking picture. So, he says that poetry is like a speaking picture. Samsarikkunna oru chitramanu. Sidney then specifies that the kind of poetry he is interested in is not religious or philosophical, but rather that which is written by right poets. He says that the kind of poetry Sidney himself is interested in is not religious poetry or philosophical poetry, but rather some poetry which was written by the right poets. And who is the right poets? This ideal form, this perfect form of poetry written by right poets is not limited in its subject matter by what exists in nature. Nature le matram, alingi environment le matra odungatilla. But instead creates perfect examples of virtue that, while maybe not real, is well suited to teaching readers about what it means to good. So, a poetry that not only glorifies or not only says about nature, but it also includes something that speaks about a moral or a virtue, or it gives a lesson about how the person should act, or what are the necessary things of a good man. Now, poetry is a more effective teacher of virtue than history or philosophy. And the reason is because instead of being limited to the realm of abstract ideas, abstract ennu vechanale thodan pattatha korach ideas, philosophy pole parayna korach ideas pole alla, allengil to the realm of what has actually happened, like history is past. Poetry can present perfect examples of virtue in a way best suited to instruct its readers. So, poetry is something that can give moral values. Therefore, it is virtue that is found in this kind of writing. Sidney devotes the final portion of his essay to a digression on modern English. poetry. There is relatively little modern English poetry. So he narrows down. Now, earlier he was generally speaking of poetry. Now he narrows down to English poetry and he says that English poetry, the contemporary English poetry, is not much good, or it is not something of a good quality. Okay. Sidney admits, however, is not because there is anything wrong with English or with poetry, but rather with the absurd way in which poets write poems and playwrights write plays. So he is not saying that it is not because of the kind of poetry. There is nothing wrong with the English language, or there is nothing wrong with the poetry as such. It is the way in which the people who are writing it, is not writing it properly. And that is why the English poetry is not of the best quality during that time. Now, poets, according to him, the poets must be educated to write more elegantly. They must write more elegantly, dignified, glorified, borrowing from classical sources without apishly imitating them. He says that English poetry can imitate a Greek poetry or a Roman poetry. It can borrow the sources, but it need not imitate them. Imitate എന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ എന്താ, അവരുടെ ആ ഒരു രീതിയിൽ തന്നെ എഴുതണമെന്നില്ല. പക്ഷേ നേരെ മറിച്ച് എന്താ ചെയ്യണ്ടേ, ദേ ക്യാൻ ഓൾവേസ് ടേക്ക് സംതിങ് ഫ്രം ദാറ്റ്. എന്തെങ്കിലുമൊക്കെ ബോറോ ചെയ്ത് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കടം കൊണ്ട് എടുക്കാൻ പറ്റുന്നതാണ്. ഓക്കെ. As so many poets, orators and scholars did in Sidney's time. So, imitation was something that was there in during the Sidney's time. Sidney's kalagattathil ezhuthikondirunna aalkaril palarum ee Greek and Roman kavithakalde imitation mathramaanu cheythondirunnathu. They did not have any stuff in their head. That is what is said. For English is an expressive language with all the apparatus for good literature, and it is simply waiting for skillful writers to use it. He says that English is a language which is abundant in different spheres. പല രീതിയിലും അതിനെ പല രീതിയിലും മോൾഡ് ചെയ്തെടുക്കാം. പക്ഷേ ഷുഡ് ഹാവ് ടു ബി ദ ബെസ്റ്റ് പീപ്പിൾ ഷുഡ് കം. സോ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ഇസ് ലൈക്ക് English language is like the ingredients that you can use in a particular cookery or particular soup or something. And who is the chef here? Chef ആയിട്ട് വരുന്ന ആരാ? നമ്മുടെ poets അല്ലെങ്കിൽ writers. They should have to use the proper ingredients, proper level of ingredients. Okay. And that is the skill in which they can develop the language. Okay. Sidney brings an apology for poetry to a close on this hopeful note. So with this, he ends his apology for poetry. But not before warning the readers that just as poetry has the power to immortalize people in words, so too does it have the power to condemn others to be forgotten by ignoring them altogether. So he says that poetry is something that can glorify or immortalize that particular moment, and the person or the it also has the power to condemn or hate others to be forgotten by ignoring them altogether. Okay, even others can be forgotten who forget poetry. Okay, the critics of poetry should therefore take Sidney's arguments seriously while compiling their poetry. So, the critics of poetry should therefore take Sidney's arguments seriously because he was the first English poet. Okay, so with this, we are going to an end to Sidney's An Apology for Poetry. And in case of any doubts, please consult me. Thank you.